from Anshei Sphard-Beth Emeth Congregation, it's time to take 10 Minutes for Torah with Rabbi Joel Finkelstein.
Welcome to our discussion of the war on Chametz. My father of blessed memory liked to say that during Pesach, or right before it, we engage in what he called the war on Chametz. We destroy it in every kind of way. We're mevatel. We annul it with words. We check for it. We clean. We then destroy it. We physically burn it as well. As Rama says, there's a custom to burn it. Let's try to understand and analyze the notion of burning Chametz. Is it that we should destroy Chametz to make sure that there is none? Sort of a passive thing. As long as there isn't any, it's good. Or is it an active thing that we have to actually go out and do an action, to an act of destruction of Chametz, to actually wage the war on the Chametz? If we look in the Torah and Parshat Bo, chapter 12, Perek Yud Bet, there it speaks about Pesach and says 7 days you should eat matzah, but on the first day you should destroy Chametz from your homes. Destroy. That's how I translate Tashbitu Sho'orim Batechem. Tashbit. Lashbit reminds us of Shabbos. Shabbos is a strange thing. When you start Shabbos, are you doing anything or you just stop working? Here it says, Lashbit, you should make a Shabbos for your Chametz. In other words, you should make it end, make it come to a conclusion. So does that mean that it just can't be? Or does it mean that you have to actively get rid of it? So let's take a look in the Mishnah in Psachim, page 21a, the second chapter. If you want to destroy Chametz, the only way to destroy it is through burning. The sages say, no, you could just crumble it and throw it to the wind. There are two versions of the sages' view. Is it that you have to do it that way? Or that no, you could also burn it. Well, what's the debate about? Well, Mishnah in Temura says that all those things that are supposed to be buried should not be burnt. Because if you want to bury it, then even if you burnt it, it's not good enough. You have to bury it. You have to bury it. And according to Srafin, lo yikaveru, if it's supposed to be burnt, then you have to burn it. If you bury it, that's not enough. So therefore, it could be a very stark debate. The Rabbi Yehuda says you must burn it. It has to be active. And the sages say, no, you just don't have any chametz. But burning it wouldn't do it because you just can't have any. And burning is not enough. It has to be has to be buried in some sort of way. But what's the halacha? Is it active or is it passive? So Tosfot says, well, since the Mishnah in Temura doesn't mention the opinion of anything other than Rabbi Yehuda, so we must follow Rabbi Yehuda. There must be an active burning. There's a mitzvah to burn the chametz on Erev Pesach. However, the Ran and the Rif and the Rambam, they follow the majority. If Rabbi Yehuda disagrees with the sages, the majority has it. Acharei Rabbi Mahatot, we follow the majority. And therefore, most authorities say, the Shulchan Aruch says, you could use any method. You could burn it, or you could throw it into the sea. You could crumble it up. In other words, we could take the passive approach. Don't necessarily have to take the active approach. So from this perspective, if before Pesach there was no, you didn't have any chametz, it would be good enough. You wouldn't have to burn it. Rama simply says, there's a custom to burn it. We find this debate between the active and passive, between Rashi and Tosfot, and the Gemara in Daf Yud Beis Amud Beis 12b in Pesachim. There, Rabbi Yehuda qualifies what he said. He says, when do I say you have to burn it? That's Shelo B'Shapiro. That is the time when people don't burn it. But the time when they burn it, you can do it any way you want. So what do they mean, the time you burn it, the time you don't burn it? Rashi says that the time that people don't burn it, that's during the sixth hour, right before Pesach. But once Pesach comes, you can destroy it any way you want. Tosfot says the opposite. That at the beginning, before Pesach, you can do whatever method you want, but on Pesach, it must be burnt. Why? Because if you let that chametz remain beyond its boundaries, that it lasted all the way till Pesach, and you get to Pesach, it's like notar. It's like you had a sacrifice and you're supposed to eat it by after 1 or 2 days, and now it's past the time. You got to burn it. So the Rabbi Yehuda makes this comparison in the Gemara in 28b. So we have to take that seriously. And therefore, at the time of the prohibition, it must be burnt. So in other words, Rashi thinks that before Pesach, there's an active act of destruction that must take place, according to Rabbi Yehuda. Whereas on Pesach, it's passive. As long as you don't have any, it's good enough. Tosafot says the opposite. On Pesach, it's an active thing. Before Pesach, as long as you don't have it, it's good enough. This debate between passive and active comes up again in the idea of bitul chametz. We know that before Pesach, we say, all chametz I have is like nothing and like the dust of the earth, it's ownerless. What does that mean? So Rashi says, that's the main mitzvah. The main mitzvah is that to destroy it. When the Torah says destroy, it means in your mind, mentally, if you don't want it, as Ramban says, in a rotze bekumo, you don't want it to exist, then it doesn't exist. It's a destruction. But the Tosfot says, no, destruction is through burning. This is simply saying that it belongs to someone else. You see, I say, that chametz, it doesn't belong to me. I have nothing to do with it. I remove myself from it. It's a siluk. When I remove myself from it, it's not mine. The law is that when chametz, even if it exists, even if it's in my house, but it doesn't belong to me, it's not my problem. That's why we sell it to a Gentile. We say, it belongs to a Gentile. It's not mine. So similarly, if I say that I have nothing to do with it, it's hefker, anyone can take it, it's not mine. That's what it is. So according to Tosfot, it's a passive thing. I have nothing to do with it. But according to Rashi, it's a destruction. It's a verbal and mental destruction of the chametz. The Rambam agrees with Rashi, and he says that the main destruction is in the heart. The Chaim Brisker mentions this idea as well. He says, if you say it's burning, then the mitzvah is done in the guf ha-chefetz. It's a mitzvah that's done in the object. It's a matter of, we can analyze it in terms of gavra and chefza. If you say it's a matter of, you just shouldn't have any chametz, that devolves upon me. I, the person, can't have any chametz. But if we say that it's a mitzvah to burn it, then it's not just, then it's an act that takes place within this object. There's a mitzvah to do the object, an act of destruction on this object. It's a mitzvah nasis beguf ha-chefetz. And the Ramban also makes this distinction. Ramban in his commentary 4b says that when we say that you should destroy it, how can you destroy it after it already exists? Doesn't make any sense. He says if you allow chametz to arrive to a point where you have to burn it, then you've already violated Pesach by having it. He says, no, the whole point is mevuar mevutal b'chatzos. The idea is it should be destroyed before chatzos. It should not exist. That's the only thing. But there is this other view he mentions that it's all about destruction with the burning, which is bitul b'yadayim, an actual physical destruction. So we have then two ways of looking at the war on chametz. One is that it's not a war, it's just passive. As long as there aren't any, it's fine. If the enemy is gone, I don't have to have a war. It's great, I have peace. The other view is, no, there must be a war. You must conduct a war on chametz. Actually, if we view chametz as either a form of idolatry, it's a symbol, symbolizes idolatry. So idolatry must be, you have to have an active war against it. Or is it enough that you don't have any? Or, if you look at it as the Yetzirah, the chametz is the evil inclination, chametz is haughtiness, chametz is traits in myself that I want to destroy, then is it enough that, well, I don't have any haughtiness, so I'm good? Or no, you should fight a battle against your ego. Okay, you should fight a battle against avodah zarah, against idolatry. This is the question. The question is there a value in the war itself? Is there a value in the act of destroying it? Is that what God wants us to do? Is to be engaged in a war on it? In other words, if we haven't engaged in the war on your evil traits, then you haven't really done the work. You happen to have the right personality, the right traits. That's not good enough. You have to engage in the war. Or do we say no? It's an object. We're interested in a certain objective. As long as you get there, it's good enough. Finally, it's interesting, this notion of bitul, of destruction. And that is that when you have destruction can be done passively or actively. Sometimes when we engage in an act of destruction, we can do it with physically. God forbid we do some physical damage to a person, to a thing, to an object. And sometimes damage can be done with words and with thoughts. That sometimes if you want to destroy something, we don't want to. We don't want to destroy things. We want to build. But sometimes destruction can be done simply with words, simply with thoughts. We have to be careful of our thoughts and our words. Words can hurt. Words can destroy. The way we speak about others, the way we speak about life itself, the way we think about ourselves can destroy us or could help to build us up. Thanks for joining us here at the Anshei Sphard-Beth Emeth congregation here in Memphis, Tennessee. Join us each week for a discussion of the holidays, the parsha, and the how-to videos as well. And thanks to Jason Lefkowitz, our producer. Thank you.
This has been 10 Minutes for Torah with Rabbi Joel Finkelstein. To learn more, visit asby.org.